now, I should like to devote some time to the digital applications. We live in a digital world. So think of ECG. It used to be on paper, right? Motor moving the paper continuously, so that was the time axis, and then there was a pen moving on the y-axis, drawing the signal from point to point, and drawing a continuous line. So this is the main and so-called analog signal. Nowadays, everything is digital. What does it mean to be digital? The difference is like between real numbers and integers. Between any two real numbers that you can find, however close they are, you can find a third real number which you can squeeze in between. Integers, there is no integer between 2 and 3. 2, 3, nothing in between. So that is so-called discrete, separate. That is what digital signals are like. And the classical ECG is continuous. No, between any two points on the drawing, you can find something in between. Nowadays, digital EEG is just a series of numbers, and it's discrete. It's represented by integer numbers on the y-axis and its value, and you don't take an infinite number of values, you don't take an infinite number of data, but just a regular integer. Because if you took, you can't theoretically take infinite number of numbers, but if you could, then even the shortest signal would take all the storage space in the world. So you have a finite selection of numbers with which you can represent real values, and you have a finite measurement instances. So you discretize, so to speak, you quantize the signal both in amplitude and in time. In amplitude, it's not a big deal. Let me give you an example. A 16-bit converter, analog to digital converter, is not a very good converter. It means that you have a selection of one bit is either 1 or 0. So 2 to 16 bits means 2 to the 16 possibilities. You have 2 to the 16 numbers with which you can represent. By contrast, here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 possible values, so it's a 3-bit representation. You have 8 different values with which you can represent a real value. But let's stick to 2 to the 16. Let's say you have a range of 3.3 volts. Okay, I'm not going to calculate it, so it can be 5 volts. The range of 5 volts you want to digitize with 16 bits of precision, it means that you have to divide the 5 volts by 2 to the 16, which is more than 16,000. So this step is less than a millivolt. And it's a bad end. It's not the best. So it's not a big deal. Well, this one can make funny things, and I'd like to show you this funny thing. So the quantization in time. It's called sampling. So it's like having a metronome, and each tick you do a measurement, and whatever you find there, you use to represent the signal there. And at regular intervals, you have a so-called sampling frequency, which is reciprocal of the same interval. And how to imagine this? For example, if you have MP3, the sampling frequency is about 44 kilohertz. Why 44 exactly? Not exactly, but why 44? I have some engineering reason, but why it's greater than 40 kilohertz? You might find out from the fact that the highest frequency we can hear is 20 kilohertz. So it's suspiciously above twice the highest frequency we can hear. And I think I can give you an explanation why it has to be twice the highest frequency we can hear. It's not worth going above because we can't hear components. But if you have image files, there's something is represented by how many pixels you have in horizontally, vertically, or all together, the megapixel value of cameras. Right? And as I told you, amplitude quantization, so how many bits you have to represent a value. tells you that two things. It's a positive statement. So if you do the sampling right, if you take enough samples, you can represent the signal without information loss. What is the correct sampling? If the fastest component in the signal is f max, then your sampling frequency has to be greater than twice this maximum frequency, or your sampling interval has to be less than the reciprocal of twice the maximum frequency in the signal, and then you don't lose any information. Okay, so in other words, greater than twice the frequency of the fastest signal component, at least three samples, that is greater than two samples in a single cycle. And what happens if you violate? Then aliasing happens. Aliasing is something different. So the signal lies about itself, lies about not its age, but its frequency. So it's an artifact, a funny artifact, but it can fool you if you are not careful. The fast signal components are aliased as low frequency components. You might have heard the term if you play computer games, because edges, when you have a slanting line on a computer screen, you can see the pixels. Anti-aliasing is to make these smoother by applying a higher resolution image in the background and interpolating. But it's easiest to understand it in time domain. This is one example of aliasing. The gray signal, the gray sign is a fast sign, so it has a frequency of about, let's say, 10 hertz. At first sign, for example, some close to 10 hertz. And these blue dots are the sampling instances. So these are the times when we collect digital information in the signal. And you can see that two samples in a period. And what will the result be? It's going to be a very, very regular sign, just not the sign you wanted to measure. A much slower sign. So you measure something else. It lies about its age. Not age, it's frequency. So you have a frequency of about 1 hertz instead of 10 hertz. Right? And this is the explanation for stuff like this. I hope we can see that.
Any viewers, okay. I think I will explain to you why carbon.
We don't need the sound, and we want. Okay, going to. Why the wheels of cars appear to rotate backwards. Okay, like here, right? You can see the wheels of cars appear to rotate backwards. Why is it? In films. So what is a film? A sampling of reality. Taking 24 pictures in a second, and with 24 pictures in a second, that is a sampling frequency of 24 hertz, you can fool your brain into seeing a continuous picture. But sampling theorem is still in effect, and it can fool you. Aliasing can happen. Remember, the signal can lie about itself at this frequency, or you can think about the stagecoaches in Western films. Sometimes the stagecoach wheel seems to rotate backwards. Stopping, it's easy, relatively easy to understand. Okay, imagine that in 1/24th of a second, okay, for simplicity, let's assume that just three spokes on the wheel, it rotates 1/3 of a revolution. Then, where one spoke was, then in the next frame, it's exactly the position of the next spoke. And you haven't labeled the spokes, so you can't see the difference. You see the very same picture in the two frames, two successive frames. That is when the stagecoach wheel seems to stand still. And if we go a little bit faster, or a little bit slower, sorry, that this spoke in the next frame is here. So this is the numbers are labels for the frames. This is the position of spoke 2 in frame 1. This moves on in frame 3 to this. And then spoke 1 Okay, so let me be a little bit more organized. Step one moves on to this position in frame two, and then to this position in frame three. So black, purple, and green are three successive frames. Of course, your brain, so what was here is here in the second frame, and then here in the third frame. Your brain could interpret like this, a big jump from here to here, and from here to here, but the solution is not possible, it would not be possible if our brains did this. Our brains interpret this series of frames in the direction of the smallest change. And what is the direction of smallest change from here to here to here? So a much slower rotation in the opposite direction. Okay, is it clear? And then, just for fun, you can play with a stroboscope and look at water droplets. Okay, I understood. The greatest lie in the world. I understood the terms and conditions. Okay, so this is where the correct frequency. We see droplets as they are. But if we change the frequency, they may slow down, stop, or go in the opposite direction. Just the stream is the same. It's a continuous stream, stream of droplets, but we're changing the frequency of stroboscope, and that is something. When stroboscope flash, I see that there is a sample, and if there is no flash, I can't see anything, there is no sample. Right? So this is how it goes. Okay, and last example. If you have spatial periodicity, break it, scan it, you have photograph, scan it with too low DPI. So the sampling frequency, spatial sampling frequency is too low. What will you get? A spatial frequency that is lower, you have ripples. Okay, periodic ripples, as if there were a gravitational wave, okay, undulating the walls. But this was just improper scanning. Okay, now, what about, so this is the basis of our digital world. So now we represent a continuous reality. Continuous, it might not be true if you think about quantum mechanics. Energy levels are not continuous energy. So even in the real world, we move towards a more discrete interpretation. But anyway, more continuous than this, it's digital. Even it concerns the Fourier transform as well. Instead of a continuous area under the curve, we have just a series of numbers from labeled from 0 to n minus 1. And these numbers represent the signal at even multiples of k of the sampling interval. And then in this regime, instead of an integral, you use a sum, but you have the same complex exponential, and you have the inverse. Okay, I haven't dwelt on the inverse. What does the inverse mean? Now, if you have the frequency information, you can turn it back to time domain. And that is, for example, filtering was about this pair of direct transform and transforming back. So you turn the information into frequency domain, you manipulate it in frequency domain, so that means on the basis of frequency information, and then you turn it back, because what you can perceive, what you can play on a speaker, or what you can project on a screen, is the direct, the time domain, the spatial domain information, not the frequency information. Okay, so a pair of discrete transforms, negative and positive, and normalization with the number of samples. What does it mean, this discrete frequency, so it's a series of numbers, n number of numbers, complex numbers. What does it mean? It represents the transform at integer multiples of a frequency unit delta f, which is just the reciprocal of your observation time. Why? So what does it mean? It means that the lowest possible frequency you can render, you can interpret, is the reciprocal of your observation time, and you have to be very careful about it, especially in life sciences. So I've worked together with a cardiologist who were interested in frequency information in the range of 0.1 Hz. sample and hope for that good a resolution. So the longer you measure, the better the resolution you have. And it's simple to understand why. So if you only observe for a length of time, t, you can't perceive, you can't potentially perceive repetitions that have a longer cycle. If you go down to the edge of the sea and observe it for 1 hour, you have no chance of detecting the ebb and tide because it has a longer cycle. Okay, so you have to observe at least as long as the cycle lasts. Okay, so that is very important. And if you multiply these discrete representations, you can see that it's going to be the multiplication of two indices. So that's why we don't have time and frequencies such just two indices. The time index and the frequency index could both contain delta t and it will cancel. So you don't have to know the resolution. It's agnostic of the resolution. Right, and what does it mean? What is the link between this discrete Fourier transform, which is abbreviated as DFT, and real continuous Fourier transform? The DFT is, it represents the real Fourier transform at frequency n times delta f, save a factor of delta t, because it's agnostic of delta t, so you have to multiply by delta t. Whenever you do, sorry, one more thing, just a technical detail, when you have real signals, not the whole spectrum is useful for you, but it has a symmetry. The upper half is just a mirror image of the lower half. This is called a Hermitian symmetry. You can use some mathematics to see that the upper half is nothing, but it can be traced back to the lower half. It's the so-called complex conjugate of the lower half. Let's not dwell on it, but this is what it means, that there is a Nyquist frequency, that is the highest frequency that is meaningful, because the highest this is something theorem tells you that the highest frequency you can still represent is half the sampling frequency, and if you use that you get a frequency which is the upper end of meaningful domains, and above this is just a mirror image. If you have a peak here in the full spectrum, you will have a mirror image of this peak. And that's why you can even save space just throwing away the mirror image and using the symmetry. And actually real world implementation use this symmetry. And what I wanted to say was that whenever you do spectral analysis, most likely you will meet the acronym FFT, which means fast Fourier transform. It's just discrete Fourier transform, just sped up. Okay. Look at the formula of discrete Fourier transform. We have n number of time domain information and n components in the spectrum. This means n squared multiplications, so for each component we have n squared n multiplications and n additions, and we have n components, so it's n squared complex multiplications and n squared complex additions. This calculation time scales with n squared. Well, if you refactor, that is rearrange, regroup it cleverly, it can be reduced significantly, and this is fast Fourier transform. So if you look at this term, you just introducing a new notation, you can see that it has a symmetry. It doesn't matter if the time domain index is first or the frequency domain. It is periodic. It can be separated into even and odd parts, and calculations can be traced back to previous calculations, so you can reuse partial calculations. This is called the Daniels and Lanzer formula, and I highlighted Lanzer because that room where you drink your coffee is called Lanzer's corner room, and that is backwards. Okay, so with many types of factorizations that exist, it's a common misconception that it has to be a power of two. It works, it's not a power of two, but it requires more cleverer regrouping, more complex regrouping. And why do we do so? Because even for short signals, it speeds up significantly, so it reduces calculation time significantly if you compare the number of operations that are required. Or for the unmodified transform, it's a huge number and it can be reduced by fast Fourier transform. Whatever signal analysis framework you use, popular Lemu biopack or lab chart. They contain these annotations. There is a, what I use, because I'm a programmer in C#, I use a C library, the fastest Fourier transform in the West. It's not worth writing your own, although I was tempted and I mixed up the WS on that and the whole thing was mixed up, so then I decided to leave, not reinvent the wheel, but use the work of professionals. And this is the fastest Fourier transform in the West. Now, I told you that periodicity is meaningful not just in time domain, but in spatial domain. So if you look at the brick wall, it has a wavelength, so to speak, in the x direction, and a different wavelength in y direction, that is, a length by which it repeats itself. And you can assign angular wave numbers in the x direction, angular wave numbers, that is 2 pi over the wavelength in the y and x and y directions, and you can extend the Fourier transform. Instead of a single term, we have a sum of 2 terms here, and instead of a single integration, it's a double integration. Well, here you can see that non-periodic structures, you can apply the Fourier transform to not strictly periodic structures. It's kind of cheating, because what the Fourier transform does is to assume that here we have the window, the registration window, and it repeats ad infinitum, so from the beginning of time to the end of time. So it extends it to be periodic. That's how it works. So when we do the Fourier transform of Lamelis symbol, for example, two-dimensional Fourier transform, it envisions, it supposes an infinite grid of infinite tile of this pattern. This is what it looks like. The center is the zero frequency, and this is the x-axis repetition, and this is the y-axis repetition. Not very informative, but if we look at simpler structures, like a sign, in the x-direction, brightness changes according to a sine function. And what can we see? We have a spot in the middle. I hope you can see the 3 spots. Okay, we have a spot in the middle, that is the average brightness. There is a spot to the left, to the right and to the left. It's because of the symmetry, the Hermitian symmetry, so frequencies always come in pairs. This corresponds to this wavelength, so you can calculate the wavelength. It's angular wave number is shown here. If you have the same, but with more closely packed, so a shorter wavelength, you will see that the dots are more spread apart because the wave number, shorter wavelength, greater wave number, right? And if you don't have a sine, but a so-called, so to speak, a square wave, either white or black, and no in between, according to the sine function, then instead of a triplet of spots, there are spots everywhere, corresponding to the fact that a square wave contains many different frequencies. And it's not just a square wave, somewhere white, somewhere black, somewhere white, somewhere black, but it's both in the x direction and the y direction. The x wavelength is longer, so on the x axis they are closer to each other. The y wavelength is shorter, so the y wave number is greater, therefore in the y axis they are more spread apart. So this is how you decode information. And if you look at just a slit, this is going to be the Fourier transform of that slit, as a rectangle, right? Okay, you can do funny things with image manipulation. For example, if you just take the Fourier transform, take the absolute value and raise it to a number, and then transform it back, depending on the value of the number, if it fits between 0 and 1, it's going to enhance the contrast. You can see it increases the contrast. Here, if the number is greater than 1, linear, because it's you might have heard it, image manipulation, it's a 1972 playboy center for Lena Soderbergh, who was just a picture at hand in the imaging laboratory, and they scanned it at high resolution and did all the image manipulation stuff, representative image manipulation stuff behind. Okay, blurring, you can do blurring on filtering. and just keep the low frequency components. So either you select the central part and throw away the rest, or you apply some gradual change. You can see different types of blurring. If it's the radius is smaller, so you keep shorter, smaller selection of frequencies, it will be more blurred. Right. High pass filtering, when you throw away low frequencies, can give you edge detection. It's sharp edge detection, so everything within is thrown away and everything else is kept, or some graduality introduced according to the Gaussian function. You can see, although it's not very striking, the difference between the two, but you can apply edge detection, very important in image sequencing, in cell separation, edge detection, different formations detected in, for example, biological or MRI, biological microscopic images in MRI or CT images. We can apply noise reduction. For example, this noise here is a slanted direction noise, manifests itself in the frequency domain as these spots. You can cancel them in frequency domain, clean the signal, and then transform back, and you've got rid of the noise. Some, I think it's like a canvas-like structure. I hope it's visible. It might magnify it. No. Okay. So back to the origin. Might be able to magnify it easily, but it represents itself as a band of noise, and you can mask this noise out, clean the signal from this noise, transform it back, and this canvas-like structure, this grid from the picture, can be removed. Okay, now another area. I started at the beginning of the talk, I mentioned the Huygens framing principle, which provides an intuitive link between optics and Fourier analysis. Let me repeat that the Huygens framing principle is about the same thing as Fourier analysis is about. If you have a complex wave, you can break it down to elementary waves, and you can understand the complex wave as a sum of element waves. That is what spectral analysis does. A complex process is broken down into elementary periodic processes, and the complex process is understood as a sum of elementary processes. Or in more complex optics, in more precise optics, Fourier analysis plays an important role. One example is that when you place an object in front of a lens at a distance equal to the focal distance, its image will be the Fourier transform of the object. Fourier transformation is used, there is a term called Fourier optics when imaging is done through the lens of Fourier transforms. You might remember that a single rectangle, Fourier transform, a single rectangle is like this. And if you compare it to a diffraction image, the similarity is striking. It's not by chance. The so-called Fraunhofer diffraction, when we view things from a large distance from a diffracted object, the wave function of the diffracted wave is proportional to the Fourier transform. So basically, it is the Fourier transform that gives you the diffraction pattern. And if you know that, if you have understood that, you can already understand holography. Okay, what do you need? Construct a grating whose diffraction pattern will be the image you want to see. Okay, so what do? Take the image, perform an inverse Fourier transform, and that will be the grid you have to construct. Why? Because the grating will do a Fourier transform, so if you feed an inverse Fourier transform, it will transform it back, and there you have your world. Okay. Or X-ray diffraction. What you see in an X-ray diffraction image is a Fourier transform of the crystal structure. And I've read in one snap, the Hungarian sports commentator called, I don't know, all of the Olympics or World Championship, pinnacle of human achievement. To me, There's one thing more boring than sports, and that is classical music, so I wouldn't call anything sports related the pinnacle of human achievement. To me, the pinnacle of human achievement is MRI. So the most complex thing that exists, and in MRI Fourier transform, in a moment, Fourier transform plays also an important role in MRI. So MRI is very, very complex. Professor Lee made a mention of it because Lama was head of his department formerly. A very important numerical component is Lama frequency. So if you have a strong external magnetic field, that's why MRI devices contain strong magnets. These magnets are used to align the spins with the intrinsic magnetic moments of protons, essentially. And this means that if you have the magnetic field, the magnetic moment of protons will not be stationary, but will so to speak, precess. The precession is like, as Professor Leahy has already told you, is like the motion of the top. When you start at the top, it's vertical, but as it gets tired, as it loses energy, it starts to sway. So it's momentary direction of momentary axis of rotation sways in a cone, and that is precession. And the magnetic moment recesses about the external magnetic field, and basically MRI, very simply put, MRI is about flipping this precession with a radio wave, a resonant absorption and emission of radio waves, which gives information, cleverly obtained information on tissue, primarily on proton density. Well, several modalities exist, so it's a very complex process. Okay, and the resonant absorption and emission of radio waves occurs at a frequency corresponding to the Lama frequency. You see, the Lama frequency is related to the external magnetic field, so it depends on whether you have a 4 Tesla or 3 Tesla MRI. And if you think about it, then what do? You turn the human body into a series of antennae. So it gives off, it emits radio waves. Problem is, what do you want? You want a map of the human body. This radio wave comes from that, this radio wave comes from that. With a single frequency, you will not be able to do that. So there is a trick, the so-called gradient magnetic field, in which to be strong external magnetic field, there is a location-dependent external magnetic field added. And then the frequency with which different body parts will signal will be made location-dependent. So if you detect a certain frequency, you will know that it came from the skull or from that area and that. So basically, what do? You encode spatial information by frequency. So your frequency will encode your spatial information. Frequency will tell you where that signal came from. And that is the domain, that is the sovereignty, that is the discretion of two-dimensional Fourier transform. So basically what you detect is a two-dimensional Fourier transform where frequency information decodes or encodes spatial information, and in MRI there is a term k-space, and the k is that k, the angular wave number. So what you have in an MRI is this, what MRI detects is a two-dimensional Fourier transform, and to get the spatial information embedded in frequency information, you have to do an inverse Fourier transform. And if you take a k-space image, the central part, as we have seen, low frequency components, spatial frequency, so it means long wavelength components, it determines the base image contrast, and at the edges of the periphery, you have information on edges, on the details, as you can see here in this picture. And finally, there's one limitation I haven't mentioned. So in order to analyze the frequencies, you have to make an assumption. It has to be stationary, so you assume that it repeats with the same frequency over and over. It doesn't change. But, for example, I'm talking to you. What do? I modulate my voice, so I keep changing the frequency. Without changing the frequency, I wouldn't be talking. I would just keep a sound change. Well, strictly speaking, Fourier transform doesn't allow these changes. What do? You restrict yourself to a small window and then slide that window over the signal. So for example, the so-called Gaussian window is used. Within that, for that small part, you calculate a Fourier transform, then you step, then you make a step, calculate it again, and then you can get a three-dimensional representation. One axis is time, the other axis is frequency, and of course you have the amplitude information. For example, I just tried out, in order to get something two-dimensional, you either use three-dimensional maps or color information to represent the third axis. So this was me trying out different Hungarian vowels, starting with R again to test reliability. And you can see the pattern is different. Whenever this is a time axis, this is a frequency axis, whenever there is some change, the spectrum changes, and I can follow the changes in the spectrum. Of course, it was discrete because I wasn't speaking continuously, just trying out limited utterances for a short amount of time. But something, or word, just happened to be my own. Okay, this is just noise. You can see that the spectrum changes. Okay, so as a speaker, turn from one sound to the other, it changes continuously. Okay, Professor Buddy has told you about cortical spreading depolarization. So you have seen this image of a ripple which is visualized by a voltage sensitive dye traveling from one corner of the visual field of vision to the other. This is a transient disruption of ionic equilibrium in the cortex. And this image here, I started with, represents it from electrophysiological point of view. This is the EEG taken from the surface of the cortex. And you can see that this disruption coincides with the silence of neurons. So the amplitude of this EEG noise gets much smaller. And we analyzed how it depends on frequency ranges. So we took it apart into alpha, beta, delta, and theta regions and analyzed how this silence of the neurons manifests itself in different domains and analyzed it according to frequency range. And that's all that I wanted to tell you. Thank you so much for your attention.
It is open for discussion. If you have questions, please ask. So I guess that I was just thinking that what mankind can present as a result. So we always think that buildings like Eiffel Tower, something which was produced by mankind. But I guess the modern imaging technology is something like this. So it put together all the knowledge. Mathematics, informatics, physics, and so on. And if you go to an MRI and just keep reading and listening this sharp noise, at the end you see what's going on in your brain. So it's really, really cool. So as I mentioned at the very beginning, school is also for stimulating. You now see that sampling is a science, data processing is a science, filtering is a science itself. But I guess for an educated person, at least the complexity in which it should be understood. So it is not just so, it is a lot of computation, time, of theory, like the Shannon, Larmor, Nyquist, which was already mentioned. So, any question?
I wanted to ask about the sampling theories. You mentioned both.
are the same. So sampling Shannon's theorem and Nyquist frequency. The Shannon's theorem, I think they both were, I'm not sure about the history of physics or history of engineering in this case, but I think they both work on the same thing, and the theorem is named after Shannon, and the frequency is named after Nyquist. So basically Nyquist frequency is the limit set by the Shannon theorem. Now I think it might have been the other way around.
Other question. So there is a lot to digest. So everything. So if you start to ask simple questions and go step by step, even this complexity could be understood. So it is at the beginning it's too bizarre that you see something, but on the other hand, you use those cell phones and filter the pictures. Now you see what's going on when we filter. What's going on when we take the high or low special frequency? Edges,